Hello, and welcome back to the scriptorium. In this program, which is number 10, we'll be discussing the joins. And you'll notice in the book that I call them the safe joins. There are unsafe joins, and the commercial cursive is full of them. But I don't want to spend much time on the unsafe joins, although later in the program I will demonstrate them and why they should be avoided. Now, the safe joins don't have to be kept to all the time. When you're doing careful, relatively careful writing, writing a letter to somebody and it's an important letter, you'll want a cursive hand, you'll want to join, but you will want to avoid joins which are, to some degree, unsightly. So these are the recommended joins. And in rapid writing, in your scribble, or in rather informal, hurried writing, you may include joins which I don't consider the safe ones. It depends on the degree of formality that you want in a particular piece of writing. Now, before beginning to demonstrate the unsafe and the safe joins, I should like to say something that sounds rather esoteric, but I think you've had enough experience now with this, by the time this 10th lesson comes along, to be introduced to a subject which is a little puzzling to someone who's not involved in writing. Let's imagine a letter N on the paper. You look at that and you say, that is an N. And the layman, the reader, would say, yes, that's an N. But I wish you would think occasionally of something else as being the N. As an analogy, let's imagine that you want to see some antelope. You can go down into the Steens Mountains in southeastern Oregon and see these incredibly beautiful animals. Their running is one of the most wonderful things in the world to watch. Now, as after the animal has passed, you can examine the tracks. And if you're a woodsman, if you're an American Indian who's lived his life in the woods, you will be able to read all sorts of things from those tracks. But the tracks are not the antelope. The edge of the pen moves. To us, the movement of the edge of the pen is it. The N is the movement of that edge of the pen, and as the edge moves, it leaves a track on the paper. So we may look on the N that's left on the paper as being an N, but as a writer, as one who's concerned with the rhythm and the beauty of writing, the effectiveness of it, we are concerned with reading the movement when we look at a piece of writing. There's an old Chinese saying that when you look at calligraphy, the brush starts moving all over again. And I wish that you would develop that kind of insight when you look at a piece of writing, that any item should show you how the pen has moved. And it's the movement that, as a writer, you want to pay a special attention to. Now, what you watch is the edge of the pen. Now, you may, when you write, as some people do, become very critical and start muttering under your breath that your hand isn't moving correctly, the pen doesn't seem to be helping, the paper is uncooperative, the ink isn't flowing properly, it may be flowing too slowly or too rapidly. So you start interfering, you start blaming the hand and blaming the tools, and you can't write. You can't write the moment you become judgmental about what's happening as you write. So I recommend that you form a clear image for your hand of the letter before you pick the pen up. If necessary, go over the model in the textbook with the pen barely touching, not even touching the paper, or you might have a dry pen and trace the letter and show your hand what that action is, what the movement is. But, and you can think about pen angle, about slope, about branching, about the elliptical nature of entrances and exits, the elliptical shoulders, and so on. But once you pick that pen up and put it on the paper, stop this critical thinking, because the head is going to get in the way of the hand if you do that. You have to say yes to your hand when you pick the pen up and start working, and tell the head to get out of the way. Tell it to go fishing or anything. That doesn't mean that you just write stupidly, leaving everything to your hand. You watch. The activity of the head then is just a cool, dispassionate, non-judgmental watching of what happens. Now, after you put the pen down, you may look and see that the hand hadn't had proper instruction. That is, then you have to go over the model again, thinking in terms of movement, of touch, and of movement, of the swing of the pen. After you have given your hand adequate information on that movement, then you can go back and start writing again, but this time too, non-judgmental attitudes, just a sharp, concentrated, one-pointed concentrated watching of what that edge is doing. It's the edge of the pen, you see, that is putting the letter on the paper. So you watch the edge. Now let's start with the problem of joins. The first group that I want to discuss are the, and I'll write large for a few minutes, are the letters that can join to letters that come before or that come after. And they are N, which has an entrance and an exit, both. When a letter has an entrance, you can join into it. When a letter has an exit, you can join out of it, provided there's a letter following it that has an entrance. Another letter that has an entrance, which is that hairline, and an exit, the crossbar is the exit. The I has an entrance, and it has an exit. The M has an entrance. These are very nice letters, and these will speed up your joining. And it has an exit. Now, it doesn't look as if E had an entrance, but it does. Notice that the M can join into the left side of E. Then you go into that wet ink up there, pull over to the right, and come down just slightly above center, and then the mid-arm of the old E comes out, and you can join into the next letter, which is, we'll use N again. So these letters join either way, that we can put an arrow, a double arrow here, meaning joining to the left and joining to the right. Now the next group of letters joins only to the right. That is the A, it is the C, it is the D, and when you practice it, go as slowly as I am. I would be writing faster if I were doing a job of some kind, but I want to move slowly so that you will see the movement of the pen, the touch and the movement. You can't join into these letters, and I'll tell you in a moment why. If you join into that A, you are going to get too heavy a top stroke. You may, if you're very slow and very careful, keep that from getting too wide, but it takes so much trouble, so much concentration, that the only way to do it is to lift the pen and then push to the left. You might, in trying to join into it, cut across like that, and that is just intolerably ugly. You might go through the counter of the A. And you see, all three of these are just utterly impossible. They make very ugly letters. C has a counter that you don't want to spoil. Now it begins to look like E. But if you come in on the top of C, again, there's a great danger that it's going to be clubbed, that it's going to be too heavy. The same way with the D. You come up here, you keep the pen on the paper, you go around like this, don't lift it, and you're likely to get an ugly club up there. And if you join it into an L, you don't lift the pen. Again, a clubbing or a loop. And clubbings and loops draw the eye and simply spoil altogether the beautiful readability of a letter. The F, there's no way of joining out of it except that crossbar, unless you want to make a loop down here. Now, in much commercial cursive, there's so much looping that you can hardly find the letters. And loopy letters are not readable letters. The L, the same way joining into an L, you're likely to club it or get a loop. So these are unsafe joins, you see. You're joining into letters that it would be better not to try joining into. Now the letters that you can join into from the left, and the textbook will show you what they are. J, this will let you in. The O, let's put an I before this O. So you could go down the left side of O and then swing around and come up there and go into that wet ink. Now, E and O both have these downstrokes which enable you to join into them. You say, well, why not do it with A? But A has that horizontal top, and that horizontal top is likely to be uglified if you try doing this. P, you could join into, but how in the world are you going to join out of it without distorting the whole appearance of the letter? That ruins the beauty of the letter, to join out of it. You may cut across the counter like that. In English round hand in the 18th century, they changed the letter into this. It looks like a J with an I after it, so that they could join out of the P. Now that just simply destroyed a nice letter. You can join out of the R, or into the R, but, and some people will join out of it, but suppose you join into an I. Do you see what you have? It looks like a bad M, a horrible M. So you dare not join out of R. Now, horizontal joins are possible, I'd say, only with T and F. The British, in their handwriting, recommend horizontal joins, but look at a horizontal join for an O. The join should be a hairline, a virtually invisible hairline. And one thing that we dislike about the commercial cursive is that there's no distinction between the hairline and the letter. In italic, the hairlines are almost invisible and the letters stand out. Now here the join is too prominent. The whole letter is scowling at you, and I hate to see a couple of O's scowling like that. The horizontal join should be invisible, and only F and T have it. Now letters that have no joining at all, letters that have their hands in their pockets, as it were. The other letters have a hand, both hands out, a hand to the left, or a hand to the right. But these letters don't have a hand out. They are seemingly a little unfriendly. You can join out of K, but it may make an ugly angle right in here. So I prefer to lift the pen. Q is a nice letter, and it's not too much trouble to lift the pen. Joining into a V is dangerous. Let's join from an I into a V here. You see that it could be misread as a clumsy W? And that's no good. Once you begin to lose legibility, lift the pen. So V, W, except joining out of F or T, you don't join into V, W, X, or Y. Now, we visited Captain Gable's school, and in that school, the children are working partly with joins. So let's take a few minutes off and watch these beautiful children at Captain Gable.
Exit stroke and diagonal join. There. My name is Inga, and I'm teaching Italic handwriting here at the Metropolitan Learning Center, which is an experimental school of the Portland Public School System. We have a chance here to teach Italic writing, Italic printing to very young children, and whenever they are interested and seem able, they can go on to cursive writing. And the joy as a teacher for me is to be able to teach them to do beautiful Italic printing and then to go right on and augment that by adding joins. I don't have to say to them, forget that beautiful printing that you've learned how to do, and now we're going to do another kind of writing, which is what we call commercial cursive with all the loops and a writing that's hard to do and very hard to read. So it's really a joy to teach such an alphabet as Italic that has such a sense of beauty and form about it to very small children, and then to be able to add the joins so they have a cursive writing that they'll use all their lives. An interesting thing about Italic to me is that in all the days and months and years I've been teaching it, I don't get tired of the forms. I really enjoy those forms, and they have an inherent beauty in them that is really a joy to be a part of that learning experience of children, to for them to be able to see these forms and to be able to do them so well. So it's a joy to be a part of that learning process for them.
I beg your pardon, I made a slip there. This was, the teacher is Inga Dubay, who is one of the of a number of extremely gifted calligraphers and teachers in the area. And she teaches both at Catlin Gable and at the Metropolitan Learning Center. And I was confused for a moment there. It's the Metropolitan Learning Center where this was filmed, this picture of the children. Well, let's try some combinations here. You'll notice in the textbook that an N chain is written out. The N chain is the alphabet in which we use N as an alternate link. And this is an excellent exercise to help you memorize the safe joins, because with N, you can join in or out. I'm not using a medium pen. It's almost the size of the B. But it's a pen I ground myself, and it will work a little better, I think, on this very rough paper. So let's try the joins. Maybe that's too much scale. The M will not join into an A, so we'll put an A down in this chain, and that joins into an N. B is the next letter. We can't join into it or out of it. Now we try N. Can we join into C? Not if we want a safe one, but we can join out of it into M. But not into D, so we lift the pen. You lift the pen only a thousandth of an inch, and it's off the paper. One reason they joined so much in the 18th century is they had a very flexible pen and a long, long nib on the thing. And that long, long shank on the pen in the 18th and 19th century meant that when they lifted a little bit, the pen was still on the paper because it was so flexible. With this stiff pen, you can lift a thousandth of an inch and you're off the paper. Now the N will join into an E, as we've seen, and out of an E, but not into an F. We can join out of an F, but not into a G. And we can't join into the G without ruining that beautiful counter in there. You see, that counter is a lovely shape, a beautiful abstract shape, especially if you close it. But to cut across it like that just ruins the whole thing. And you have to ruin the counter if you're going to join out of it. You can't join into H without making an ugly clubbing or loop, but you can join into H. Into I. And I goes into M. M goes into J. But there's no way of getting out of the J. K, I would leave alone for the sake of not getting an ugly angle down here. You see, K has that diagonal coming over to the right, and it's likely to push the next letter over too far. And we use the joins partly in order to memorize this proper spacing between letters. And the join, the hairline join, will space letters for you. And you see why we have to have an edge that's up at a 45 degree angle, at least, if we're going to get almost invisible hairline joins. Into O. P, we can go join into it, N. Cut out of it without ruining the counter or making an ugly base. Q, like A and G, we can't get into it, but unlike A, we can't get out to make a join. We can get into R, all right. But as I showed, if you join R into something, you're likely to get a counter or something that looks like another letter. Some of the British say, well, make a dip in the R like that. Now you can get an I, and it looks like R-I, all right. But it's more trouble, I find, to make that dip than it is to lift the pen. This takes much less time and less trouble than that. So, M, S. Now you notice this is a slightly different S. Now there are three letters that are changed when you join into them. When I is unjoined, when you don't join into I, it shapes, the entrance is elliptical. When you join into it, put an NI down, you come in from underneath like that. So it's a slightly different construction from that. This is the letter when it's semiformal and alone. This is I when you're joining into it. The other letter is a U. A U has that elliptical sort of entrance when the letter stands alone in semiformal writing. But if you join into it, like the I, you join in from under, an underhand stroke like that, and then the S is the third letter, which is altered somewhat. Now, it still resembles S. What it lacks is this top, but let's look at that again. Now, can you see that that is the origin of the commercial cursive S, which tends to degenerate into an I stroke? That is, if this is S, I find very often in student papers, not in the calligraphy classes, but say in my art history class when I taught it, that the S just became an I stroke. It didn't resemble the old S. The T is such a nice letter, and the fact that it's very friendly, very cooperative, you can go into it and out of it. Now we've already discussed U can join into M, but then how about V? It's likely to cause trouble because this part, aside from that vertical, begins to look like a bad W. So I'd say with V, W, X, and Y, let's lift the pen. And you'll get used to it. No trouble to lift it. since it's stiff and will come off the paper. You try joining X into things, and you do get some of the strangest looking combinations. The letters become immediately illegible. And Z is no good at all. See, that begins to look like a commercial cursive R. And so I would avoid joining into the Z. This counter in here is very misleading. But if the letter stands alone, there's no difficulty whatsoever reading IZ. Now, I recommend that you work with the alphabet sentence. The quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. That quick brown fox is our totem, and he's a very friendly beast, so let him work for you. And you'll discover that UIFOUMPERHE are the only joins, and you can see what they are in the textbook. Let me write in the few minutes that are left, or in the moment that's left, some words with joins. One of my favorite for practicing joins. Now notice you use wrist action with this. Moment. Moment. Communion. Commencement. Monomania. Commandment are excellent words to work with. See, the M-O joins. We put a line under it. M-E-N-T, they're all joined. But notice that we lifted the pen here, and I'll indicate that with a vertical. We indicated it here. Now we'll go on with these signs next time.